In this video, we'll look at how you can modify your controller actions to satisfy critical constraints and action bounds for control systems modeled in Simulink. Specifically, we will look at an example of enforcing constraints on a system states for a PID controller application. The Simulink model here models the dynamics of a plant given by these system equations. Each of the subsystems here model the dynamics for each of the states. These are the control loops set up here with PID controllers that enable desired tracking of references for each of the plant states. Now let's consider a controller objective where the states of the plant together must track a circular trajectory given by the set of equations here. Additionally, there is a constraint that either of the plant states should not exceed 1. Now, we have constructed the reference trajectory for each of the states from the equations that the PID controllers can use. When the simulation is run and the trajectory is plotted, you can see that the PID controllers do a good job of reference tracking. However, the states X1 and X2 both exceed 1 while tracking the trajectory here, violating the constraint. This is because the PID controller here can only directly control the input to the plant and not its states. Now this is where the constraint enforcement block can help modify controller inputs to enforce these critical constraints on plant states. This block, introduced in R2021A version of Simulink control design, uses a quadratic programming solver to solve a real-time optimization problem to find a control input U that satisfies these constraints. So at every time step, the constraint enforcement algorithm checks if the constraints are violated, and if they are, it selects an action closest to the nominal action U0 such that the constraints are observed. Here, the coefficients of the constraint function fx and gx can be linear or nonlinear functions for the plant states. C is the bound for the constraint function, while umin and umax are the lower and upper bounds of the control actions respectively. If the coefficients of the constraint function are already known, you can apply them directly to this block. However, if you're unable to derive the constraint function from the plant, you can use the input-output data from experiments or simulations to learn the coefficients, for example, by using a deep neural network. For this example, we know what the constraints are, so let's specify them. The feasible region for the plant is given by this constraint, so the next state condition should satisfy the constraint. Now, we can approximate the plant dynamics by using this equation. TS here is the time step, which is the sample time which we have set in the model. As the next state should not exceed 1, we can apply the constraint to this equation. This gets us the constraint function in the form which the block needs. Here, fx, gx, and c are given by these matrices, and we will feed these coefficients into the constraint enforcement block. In the model, we have put up a gain block here to represent the coefficient fx and a MATLAB function block to represent gx. Under the parameters of the block dialog, let's set the number of constraints and actions to 2, since we have 2 states to enforce constraints on and 2 PID controller actions to bound. For constraints, let's use an external source. And we can connect a constant block with the vector 1,1 to represent the constraint bound C from the constraint function. With the constraints defined in the block, we can hook this up between the controllers and the plant. The nominal control input U0 will feed in from the controllers, and U star would be the modified actions feeding into the plant. As you can see here, the model has been modified to incorporate the constraint enforcement block between the PID controllers and the plant. Now let's rerun the simulation. Here we see the PID controllers start tracking the desired trajectory while the constraints are being satisfied. Then in this region exceeding 1, where the constraints will be violated, the constraint enforcement block successfully constrains the control actions of the PID controllers such that the planned states remain less than 1. So in summary, we saw how you can use the constraint enforcement block to modify control actions such that the planned states do not violate critical constraints. This block can be applied in any control loop, especially with control strategies where it's not possible to specify critical constraints, such as PID controllers and reinforcement learning. Further, you can generate C or C++ code from this block and deploy it on hardware.